This is Whitley Strieber, and this is Dreamland. You've reached the edge of the world.
Welcome back to Dreamland. I'm your monthly guest host, Kelly Chase. Whitley will be back at the helm next week. Over the last few months, I've been working on a docuseries being produced by my media company, Ontocalypse Productions, called The Beyond, UFOs and a New Reality. It features names that you're likely familiar with, including Whitley Strieber, Jeff Kripal, Michael Masters, Diana Walsh-Pasulka, James Madden, Mario Woods, Greg Bishop, James Ian Dolley, and many more. We're wrapping up production now, and it should be live on Apple TV and Amazon Prime within the next couple of months. I'll be sure to let you all know here once we have a solid premiere date. The process of making this docuseries has been profound and transformational. And so today, I wanted to take a moment to share a conversation with the director of The Beyond, my dear friend and business partner, Jay Christopher King. Jay is the co-founder and director of the Experiencer Group, as well as the co-founder of the Inquiry into Anomalous Experience and the Phenomenon Conference Series. A lifetime experiencer himself, Jay is one of the most open, nuanced, and innovative thinkers I've come across in the field. He's a tireless advocate for experiencers and one of the hardest working people you'll ever meet. I'm so excited to be able to share this conversation with you and to give you a sneak peek into our upcoming series. So without further ado, here is my conversation with Jay Christopher King. Well, hello, Jay. Welcome to Dreamland. How are you?
I'm doing great. It's a pleasure to be here, Kelly. Thanks for having me on.
I love how we're doing this. Like, we don't talk to each other like six times a day, but
exactly.
Here we are.
But here we are. And like, we can actually see each other. And, you know, we turned our lights on in our studios and here we are. Absolutely.
Yes, we did. We did get you up for this one. Great to see you.
That's
too.
Right. Yeah.
So it's so great to have you. I've been wanting to have you on since this whole thing started with me here on Dreamland. I've been looking forward to this conversation. And yeah, so for members of Dreamland, I'm sure a lot of people know who you are. For anyone who doesn't, can you tell people a little bit about who you are and how you got into this crazy field?
Sure. Well, my name's Jay Christopher King, as you can see down here. And I came into this field because I had anomalous experiences of my own, starting when I was a child. I lived in a few houses that people would commonly consider haunted, for lack of a better term. It's often pretty appropriate. So when I was about 6 years old, I lived in a house that had a lot of kind of poltergeist phenomena and shadow beings and the apparition of a small child. And there's a lot going on in that home. And later, when I was around 9 or 10 years old, I had my first experience with non-human entities with that I can recall anyway, with small grays at that time. And that, as happens with a lot of folks, it wasn't a solitary encounter. And there were repeated very unpredictable encounters that picked up again during adolescence and then in my mid-20s as well. And as a lot of folks know in the experiencer community anyway, that wasn't kind of like the limit of or the only types of anomalous modalities that I've experienced. But those are two of the big headlines, I guess, that people would know about me. And I am a television producer, as we'll probably talk a little bit later. I have a long history with that. I went to school out in New York City for art and then went to film school for my master's and started working basically for cable TV shows for years. And then I started kind of questioning for a while, like I recognized that the TV shows that I was making were not really the kind of shows that I would generally watch often. And I kind of, you know, had some navel gazing, soul searching moments about that and started kind of finding myself in a seeking vein. And I started doing some work for the UFO historian Richard Dolan And that led me in the early months of the pandemic to start hosting support groups for other experiencers to compare notes and chat. And during those early lockdown months, some of those encounters would last, some of those Zoom encounters, support groups would last 5-6 hours. It was crazy. I mean, just because a lot of people had never had an outlet like that before. And of course, just the whole, you know, boredom and being cooped up in the house back in those days. I mean, my local park wasn't even open. I couldn't even go for walks, you know, where I normally do at that time. I mean, I think that was true for a lot of us. I just found that every time that me and Kirsten Blackburn and Stuart Davis would organize a new support group Zoom session, it would just fill up right away. And we recognized that there's a need to have more community efforts online for experiencers. And so we co-founded the Experiencer Group back at the beginning of 2021. And I've become the director of the Experiencer Group. And I work with a team of volunteers to help get people situated and vetted. And the Experiencer Group is a private online community for people that have had anomalous experiences of any and all kinds. So not just ghosts or NHI encounters, but also people that have experienced precognition, out-of-body experiences, near-death experiences, the whole gamut. Yep.
That's wonderful. I love the Experiencer Group. I'm a member. And, you know, something that I think is overlooked a lot in the conversation that we don't talk about enough is that experiencers tend to have lots of different modalities, like more than one. Can you talk about that a little bit and how, you know, sometimes people are kind of questioned in their credibility because they're like, well, how could it be that you experienced, you know, abduction and haunting and precognition? And, you know, if you want to talk about that a little bit.
Sure. Yeah, absolutely. I mean, I think that there's a growing understanding among some in the community and even beginning now in the scientific community at large. Through the work of people like Gary Nolan, that it's possible that some people, a certain contingent of anomalous experiencers, actually just maybe are processing their environment a little bit differently or have a slightly expanded sense of perception than some other folks do. I've found this to be true myself in that, like, people who don't consider themselves experiencers may have a harder time, like, literally seeing something in front of them. And when an experiencer points it out and says, no, look, that kind of looks like a cloaked predator kind of situation over there. Do you see that over there? And then they're like, oh, yeah. Huh. It's one of those things where it's like, once you see it, you can't unsee it. And it seems like some people, they get kind of turned on in that way. And then they become aware, you know? And I don't know why that is. You know, there's a lot of theories about that, but I think that, you know, that's a current theory for why anomalous experiencers actually experience sometimes a wide array of things that they've seen or things that they've heard. You know, I see different kind of general categories in terms of folks that have multiple modalities. And one thing that I notice is that through working with thousands of experiencers at this point through the Experiencer Group, that often they seem to be one of the big tags is like, what is your dominant sense? Or what is the dominant sense with which you kind of put a foot forward into the world? And so a lot of visual artists have a lot, for whatever reasons, tend to see more. And then I found that other people, you know, sometimes like a writer might experience automatic writing, that if people are often people involved in music or things along those lines will have more clairaudience. So being able to hear things more, sometimes in terms of like mediumship and things like that, I find that a fair amount of musicians have mediumship capabilities. So there's these kinds of like strange corollaries, and it's been wonderful over the last few years to be comparing notes with other experiencers to find those kinds of corollaries, to see the kind of network that sometimes happen with people with multiple modalities and anomalies, or what people think of as anomalies. Because as you and I are beginning to understand, this is actually much more normal than people might think. And at the end, they may not be anomalies at all, but just a wider vantage point for the environment that we live in. It may just be nature altogether, an expanded understanding of nature.
Absolutely. Well, you and I have spent the last several months kind of in the trenches creating this docuseries that'll be out soon, The Beyond, UFOs in a New Reality. And part of the reason that I was so excited to work with you on this, not just because you're a delight and one of my favorite people, but because you are so close to the experiencer side of this conversation, and in a lot of ways are having conversations directly with experiencers all the time. So you're kind of, closer to the source in a way than a lot of people are. And so I was wondering if you could talk a little bit about, how you see your role, in kind of what we're doing in terms of, how do we create media that is more respectful of experiencers, that presents like the full scope of their stories and that sort of thing? Like what did you want to do different with our docuseries than what you've seen out in the world?
That's a great question. One of the things that I thought was most necessary was to have one of the most brilliant writers working in ufology today. And that's you. So
the
that
Mutual Admiration Society today.
That's right. That's right. But literally couldn't do it without you. We're absolutely a team in this. And our wonderful teammate Jordan Flowers as well. But as far as like what I wanted to do from an experiencer perspective, I mean, you're an experiencer yourself as well. I think you and I had a lot of conversations early on about one of the best ways you could be respectful for experiencers is just try to do as accurate of a job as possible in letting them speak about what happened, and to not edit anything, not edit inconvenient details. We edit for time. You always have to edit for time in a TV show, and you'll shoot for hundreds of hours and it'll come down to one or three or five. But, I think that was one of the most important things that came up in our early conversations and has really persisted and will be seen in the final product. I believe, I'm very confident that people will see that, the true kind of thorny, challenging complexity that often comes about. I mean, I don't have to tell, every listener at Dreamland about situations like that, because Whitley, of course, has done such an amazing job and a lyrical job talking about similar complexities for years now. So, Whitley absolutely was, of course, a huge inspiration for this project. And we were so lucky to be able to bring him in to the fold and shoot with him when you and I were both out at the first Soul Symposium last November. It's amazing.
Yeah, no, I love that. And it's so great to have Whitley involved. There's so many considerations, I think. We had talked a lot going into this docuseries about the things that we wanted to do differently, which isn't in any way to be meant to be a dig at, media that already exists, because, obviously we're kind of standing on the shoulders of giants here, right?
100%.
It's the only reason we're even able to do this work. And so it's not that, but we do want to think about, how we can do things better. And I know one thing that, we talked about a lot was that it's really difficult in a visual medium to convey some of these stories, because you can't just have somebody's head talking to you for 20 minutes. Like, people, our poor ADD brains that we have from, the internet has basically destroyed most of our brains at this point. But people can't just sit there and stare at that. They need something else visually going on. And if you want to represent these things accurately, and to not just rely on stock video that may have been made by somebody, or most likely was made by somebody who's never had an experience or has never seen a UFO, So can you talk a little bit about how you kind of were problem solving around that challenge and what people can expect to see in the docuseries?
For sure. Yeah, that is an incredibly important point. Yeah, I mean, especially given that we're working with a relatively limited budget. It's certainly, you know, much larger than most podcasts operate at. However, for a television show, it's quite small. And that was partially out of necessity and partially by design, to see how lean we could be and really produce something powerful, and be able to be financially successful. I mean, you know, that's Jordan's influence to a large degree. I mean, you know, you and I are fine just like taking on windmills, you know, Don Quixote style, like left and right, I think. But like, you know, thanks to him, we were able to start really framing things in a way to say like, okay, well, but like, we want to make sure people get their money back. And, you know, our backers, you know, who are individuals and mainly just, you know, people from the experiencer group and listeners of the UFO rabbit hole, actually, which is incredible, you know, but that was very important. So, you know, what do we do in a lean situation? And of course, like part of that is to use stock footage. And there's these great stock footage companies out there like Getty and others that you can basically become a member of and pay a pretty serious amount of money, actually, to be able to use, you know, aerial photography of San Francisco or some cabin in the woods or, you know, somebody washing their hands or using a chalkboard or whatever. But, you know, as you and I both know, and as our primary editor knows right now, very intimately, they're like, if you go on a lot of those, they're, you know, if you type in alien, you're going to see some janky old CGI, like green alien, you know, you're going to see things that are not very accurate. They're accurate to the history of science fiction and conceptions of that in TV and movies, but they're not accurate often to what people report. Right. And so I think that, you know, that is a niche that is an area that we're really wanting to kind of flood the zone with, not just with this project, but in general with Ontocalypse, the company that we co-founded. So in this project, we are using experiencer art that has been individually created to describe the situations that have happened. We have oral testimony from people, verbal testimony from people, giving the accuracy. And we also are using folks like Finn Handley, who goes by Finn365 online, who does incredible recreations of people's encounters. I love the work that he does. He uses often freeware and other software programs like Blender, and he works with experiencers directly to try to really dial in the details of what happened in their experiences. And he does these recreations that are often like actually take the amount of time that the experience happened. And so he tries to time it out correctly. And if somebody was driving, he'll, you know, make sure that he'll find it on Google Maps and find the exits that are around there and recreate the whole highway, recreate the car, you know, recreate the speed that the person thought they were going at, all these details, recreate the sky that would have been like out that night. And an incredible amount of work. And he's been a fantastic person to work with on the series. And he's been doing painstaking recreations of the encounters of people like Mario Woods, one of the most important, in my mind, living experiencers in terms of like what issues and relevant issues within the current discourse his encounters have kind of touched.
No, I loved, it's one of my favorite parts of the docuseries is that recreation of Mario Woods' story, because I was very familiar with Mario Woods' story. And then especially after, you know, we were having him on the series, obviously I did a deep dive and did a ton of research. And, you know, he's told his story in visual media before, but it changed how I saw it, like because a lot of times people are kind of like fudging details or, you know, like I didn't understand the scale of what he was seeing. And I didn't understand just the the weirdness of it. Like, there was so much to it. I don't want to give too much away so people can kind of have that moment when they watch. But it changed the way that I saw the case. And I know that Mario was very gracious and grateful that, you know, he was being asked questions that he hadn't been asked before about, you know, his experience. And I just thought that was really cool.
That's right. Yeah. It's been amazing to work with him. I think he's a really inspiring guy. He has, I believe Mario has a ton of integrity. He's just a great guy. And, you know, I met his family. Me and Jordan went down there to hang out with them and shoot, and just a really incredible experience. You know, one of those situations where, like with a lot of experiencers, it's not just the first thing, as Jeff Kripal even says in our show, you know, like, there's always more than the story you initially hear. There's always more. And with Mario, that's absolutely true. There's so much more to a story than what people have heard before. And I really look forward to sharing more of that in terms of like the depth and him being able to connect it to things that happened when he was a child and what happened like years later and what happened for other people in his family, as we often know that there's kind of a lineage aspect that often happens in situations like this. But yeah, like some of the details, like for example, his partner, Michael Johnson, on that fateful night in 1977, when he had these encounters with these beings, near, a nuclear launch site, actually, that he was guarding. It turned out that over all the years, not a single UFO researcher until us asked him what Michael Johnson looked like.
I know, that's crazy. You know,
it's strange. He was like, you know, nobody's ever asked you that before. You know, it's common knowledge that he's an African-American man, but like nobody's gone into more depth to try to like to really picture him before. Right. And you know, I just one night I was like, so Mario, like, can you think of anybody like that, you know, of like any celebrities, any athletes, anybody that kind of looks like Michael Johnson did back in those days? And he was like, oh my God, like nobody's ever asked me that before. He looked like that actor Terrence Howard did when he was a kid, you know what I mean? When he was young. And I was like, amazing. Never would have pictured that exactly. And he was like, no, he looked pretty much exactly like Terrence Howard minus the box cut. And I was like, oh, wow. How about that?
I have an conspiracy theory.
Right. Pretty amazing. But yeah, I love that aspect. And I think that, you know, that'll translate for a lot of people out there that are experiencers themselves and, you know, appreciate, say, Whitley's work or, you know, have experiencers in their lives that, you know, might be part of the reasoning why they seek out shows like our docuseries and others like that. Yeah.
Absolutely. Well, we're going to take a quick commercial break and we will be right back. Hi, everyone. This is Kelly Chase. I'm Dreamland's new monthly guest host. You can catch me here on the last Friday of every month. If you're interested in checking out my other work, you can find that on my podcast, The UFO Rabbit Hole. On that show, I share my own personal research with deep dives into everything from historical cases to philosophical frameworks, as well as in-depth interviews with top thinkers in the field, like Jeffrey Kripal, Diana Walsh-Pasulka, Bernardo Kastrup, James Madden, and of course, Dreamland's own Whitley Strieber. You can find the UFO Rabbit Hole on Apple Podcasts, Spotify, YouTube, or wherever else you listen to podcasts. Just search for the UFO Rabbit Hole. And if you like what you hear and you want to go even further down the rabbit hole with me, I'd like to invite you to join my Patreon community. Patrons get perks like early access to new content and ad-free episodes. I host twice monthly patron-only Zoom calls where you can ask me questions, share your own thoughts, and connect with others. We also have a lively and active private Discord server where members host book clubs, happy hours, and just share their thoughts on all things anomalous without all the drama that's all too common on social media. It's a warm, open-minded, and vibrant community, and we'd love to have you join us. Memberships start at just $5 a month. You can sign up at patreon.com/UFO rabbit hole. That's patreon.com/UFO rabbit hole. So speaking of Mario Woods, he is kind of one of the anchor experiencers, I would say, in this project. And we have another one whose name is Courtney, who's kind of on the opposite end of the spectrum in some ways in terms of his experience and how he has integrated it and what it's meant to his life. Can you talk a little bit about the juxtaposition between those two stories and why, you know, we felt that it was so important to include those two stories as kind of a foil to each other?
Absolutely. That's a great question. Yeah. So Courtney is an incredible guy. He's does wealth management. He's worked as an investor that would be known from project involving Silicon Valley, for example. And he lives down in Texas. He lives down in East Texas. And so Courtney's case is very interesting and kind of works as a bookend to Mario's in some ways, because Mario's is one of the kind of imminent encounters in the way that we often experience ufology, which is from the lens of military encounters. And so, you know, Mario's case is such an exemplary situation that way. In terms of, I mean, it's a really historical case. It's a deeply important case, partially because it did such an amazing job of, you know, unfortunately for Mario, of being able to really speak to the cover-up that's happened over years. He was threatened. He had to sign documents saying that he wasn't going to talk about it while he worked in within what he did. You know, at that time, he was working with the Air Force. He later worked with the Department of Energy. At national labs and doing really important work like that, where he had to have a cube clearance, like a nuclear clearance, to be able to carry weapons around in nuclear facilities and things like that. So he was trusted on a very, very high level within the military. And, you know, after he retired, he felt comfortable eventually, you know, coming forward and telling a story of encountering this giant craft that really kind of looked like a giant fireball, huge, over the blast doors of this nuclear launch site. And we now know through the work of people like Robert Hastings and others that, and Robert Salas and others that it seems that grays and maybe other forms of non-human intelligence have a fascination, and seem to be monitoring our nuclear capabilities on a pretty regular basis. So Mario's case is fascinating in a lot of ways because it touches on a lot of the kind of relevant stories that we've been hearing in recent years. But it also gets into the beings themselves. And I think fans of Whitley and Dreamland in general will find that relevant, that often in these military encounters, you know, it's often framed, you know, kind of through the lens of people like great people like David Fravor, Alex Dietrich, Ryan Graves, et cetera, that have encounters like with the Tic Tac. But they don't see the occupants, what have been called the UFO occupants or the UFO pilots and these kinds of euphemisms. But one of the things that I really enjoyed that we were able to do with the show was to really take an unflinching look and be like, no, there are grays there. There were small grays and there was even a tall gray there. And really going into a little bit more detail about that, because often those details get wiped out. You know, there are not a lot of shows that even talk about how there are small and tall grays and how they behave differently. And like, why is that? And speculating about the history of that. So there's Mario's case, which does a great job from that kind of a framework. And then there's Courtney's case, which is the kind of case that you don't often hear about online. And in some ways, one of the closest corollaries that you might be able to find in contemporary ufology might be Chris Bledsoe, a similar case where somebody experiences a range of modalities on, and they kind of follow them around, but it also seems to have a center point of a place. And that's definitely the case with Courtney, where he, I don't know how much to spoil on the show today in terms of like where Courtney lives, but he lives on this fascinating ranch in East Texas that had never been talked about publicly before now. But it has poltergeist phenomena. There are cattle mutilations that happen there. People see apparitions of the dead. There are UFO sightings. There was a UFO sighting while we were shooting there earlier this year. And so, you know, Courtney has a long history, and he does within his family as well. So there's a lineage aspect. We talked to his grandmother, who has incredible precognitive capabilities. And, you know, it hasn't come forward before now, but, you know, she has utilized her precognitive capabilities in the past in really incredibly impressive ways that maybe we should save for later in terms of talking about. But anyway, it's to say that, like, essentially, like, Courtney's case points at the kinds of cases that we don't often hear about in terms of, like, it there being a UFO component, but there also being, like, a regular immersion in synchronicities in day-to-day life where this stuff just is kind of what people experience. And it seems to be about an expanded sense of perception in a lot of ways. And that seems to be true for many generations of his family. Like, one of his children has already demonstrated extraordinary capabilities in the same way, and it goes back many generations. So, and he has no military history, Courtney himself, right? He's a very highly capable person. He's a straight shooter. He has a lot of integrity. He's an incredibly thoughtful, bright person that has a very successful career in business. And he also happens to be a lifelong experiencer. And I think we both, you know, when we first heard about his case, we were just like, if he ever wants to go public, if he ever wants to talk about it, if he ever does something like that, how beneficial it could be to the community. For all of those reasons that we stated, and also that he's a Black experiencer and, you know, from an African-American family that has been in East Texas for quite a long time, for hundreds of years. And within his area, it's a prominent African-American family. So, you know, those are not often stories that we hear about in our culture. And, you know, there's all sorts of reasons that we could come up with for why that is, you know, and there's exceptions to that rule, of course, like Barney Hill, for example, one of the pivotal experiencers ever of abduction phenomena is a Black man. But we don't see it very often. And so that also seemed important. I mean, it didn't just seem important. I think it was incredibly important to the both of us to be able to start opening the aperture. Because as you and I know, partially because of language barriers, for all sorts of different reasons, there's not as much dialogue as there should be between like the Western, you know, predominantly white community, the Western community in general in America, and other world cultures and even minority cultures within our own country with regard to this phenomenon. And we can learn a lot that way, I think. Wouldn't you agree?
Yeah, absolutely. And I feel like I really did learn a lot. I learned so much just through this process. I think you really can't overstate the importance of, like, you can read all the books in the world, but getting out in the field and really talking to people, and especially talking to people from different backgrounds than you, is really helpful. And I feel like I learned so much from spending time with Courtney and his family at the ranch. And one of the things that really stands out to me, too, is being kind of a core difference between Mario and Courtney's case, and something that I think makes all of this conversation so much more important, is that Courtney was able to sort of show me what it looks like when someone is able to fully integrate the kind of anomalous experiences into their life, into their cosmology, into their religion, into their family history, and the kind of just like groundedness and purpose that gives a person. And then on the flip side, you know, Mario is also an extraordinarily like grounded, full of integrity, you know, purpose driven human being.
Absolutely.
But But also, he's had to deal with, for years, you know, the secrecy that was around his case, the, you know, the things that he wasn't allowed to say out loud, you know, having this partner that was there with him, and then that guy just disappears and you never hear from him again. Like, he wasn't given the opportunity to integrate in the same way that Courtney was, and that lack of integration can be really harmful to people, to their, you know. And I wonder if you could talk a little bit about that, because I know that so much of what you do is helping people who are integrating their anomalous experiences.
That's right. Thank you. I appreciate you bringing that up. Yeah, I think one of the key points, spoiler alert, but one of the key points in Courtney's case that I think is so touching and so important is that his grandmother helped him normalize these experiences at a very young age. And so Courtney was made to feel comfortable about these experiences in early childhood. His grandma would take him out into the yard and look at stars at night. And Courtney's grandmother has a long standing, since childhood, encounters with UAP, with UFOs. And fascinating cases, and, you know, and the details that she was able to bring out even in her early 80s now are incredible to people like me, because they're less reported craft types and things like that, but they are in the literature if you dig. And she's not exactly the type of person that would know the work of like Timothy Good or some of these like, you know, lesser known researchers out there that would have covered cases like this back when she was of the time when she was a child. So where am I going with this? So I just lost my thread. Where are we?
That's okay. How she helped him integrate his experience.
Yes. Yes. Thank you so much. You know, she would take him out into the yard and they'd look at stars. And Courtney has a theory that she was pretty sure that if she took him out into the yard often enough, that a UFO encounter might happen. And that's exactly what happened. And she was able to talk to him, you know, after it happened and in the years after, and was able to really normalize that it wasn't just this kind of family secret of precognition and kind of remote viewing that was very commonplace within their family structure. You know, he has a lot of stories about family members calling him up, you know, because they saw something that was either going to happen to him that day or had already happened that day. And, you know, seeing if he was all right with what they viewed, with what they remote viewed and things like this. The fascinating situation, but then that there is an external element, you know, UFOs, UAPs, situations like that. And I think that, you know, one key point there is that if we're able to start normalizing these conversations with young ones and with our family members, that can do a lot towards integration and can even bring us closer to our loved ones in a lot of ways. Because, you know, it's intimate. And often these are private situations. And, you know, as Dr. Stephen Finley, who's in our show as well, a ufologist and an African American studies professor, you know, as he puts it, you know, like some aspects of this, of the phenomenon that Courtney's family experienced are relatively common, but it's not as common for it to be spoken about and process so easily among almost all members of the family group, which is extraordinary. And I think could provide like an incredible example to people today and in the future in seeing and being inspired by how warm his family is with each other and how this has brought a depth that a lot of people would admire. Absolutely.
No, I agree. And one of my favorite moments from the whole of our filming was, you know, we've talked about how we do our best to relay experiencers' accounts as accurately as possible. But we are also making a show. And so, like, there are certain times you're trying to get a soundbite. And a soundbite we tried a few times to get out of Courtney was him being kind of like, wow, isn't it crazy that all this stuff happened? But, like, he didn't bite on that. And I'm glad that he didn't. And he really pushed back because he was like, is it weird? Like, because to him...
That's right. Yeah.
You know, to him, it's not that extraordinary. And just thinking about that really inspired me thinking about what the world could be like if people were able to integrate these things and have a framework to understand them, you know, particularly starting at a younger age, and how that might change our culture in general. It seems like there's this part of our humanity that we've kind of cut ourselves off from. And Courtney's family seems to be such a beautiful example of the possibilities when you allow that kind of magic and enchantment back into your life.
I completely agree. I absolutely completely agree. And, you know, I experienced this as when I was younger, I was able to speak with my mother about my anomalous experiences, and then was able to talk with my younger sister about them and my stepfather. And with other people in the family, it was more of a secret for us, and especially for me. And then as I got older, I understood just how much stigma there was around anomalous experiences. And it became a huge stumbling block. I was a relatively outgoing kid, you know. I'm arguably right, you know, on the Myers-Briggs test, I'm like right in the middle. I'm able to do things like what we're doing right now, and then sometimes I have to go like put a bag over my head and be an introvert for 3 hours to rest and recuperate after things like that. But, you know, part of that was just because like I developed an extraordinary amount of social anxiety as a youth and into my 20s after I moved to New York City, going to art school. This persistent fear that people were going to find out and that people would shun me or judge me or leave me. Like, I had a strong worry about friends or loved ones leaving me, partially because I did have friends through childhood and through my early 20s and romantic partners that experienced things with me, and that some of them hadn't experienced things before. And they, you know, they recognized, some of those people, that if they stopped hanging out with me, those situations wouldn't continue, and those situations freaked them out pretty bad. So on the one level, I completely understand. I absolutely understand. But that also, for me, was like a strong sense of fear that really kind of shaded my life for over a decade, you know, almost 20 years, more even. It really affected like how I was able to walk in the world, and a palpable internal feeling like I had a lack of honesty, because I couldn't be myself in the world and I couldn't share some of these more profound aspects of my life. Yeah. And so I'm glad to see situations and solutions that are so caring and loving, like what happened in Courtney's family.
Absolutely. Well, we're going to take a quick commercial break and we'll be right back.
Have you ever read Communion? Or have you never read Communion? It's out in a new edition. Very powerful, a subtly new cover that reflects the fact that the visitors are now looking back at us because they truly are. You can get it from the unknowncountry.com store as a Kindle, as a beautiful, sumptuous paperback, or as an unabridged audiobook read by me. It's the first time in the whole life of Communion that it has been read in full in audio format. And believe you me, I felt that reading. I put my life, my memories into it, and I trust you can hear it in the voice. I sure felt it while I was reading. So get communion, listen to it, read it. Communion is of central importance to all of our lives.
Well, I will say, as someone who is your friend and spends a lot of time with you, that you, it definitely does make life weirder. So I can...
Yeah, we've had some anomalous experiences together, haven't we, Kelly? Yeah.
We sure have.
Some of them are a little too hot for TV, but that's all right.
We sure have. But it's worth every second, and I'm glad it's happened. And
I appreciate that.
But speaking of, you know, talking, part of wanting to center experiencer narratives more and to treat them with the respect and dignity that they deserve is that we can't just tell the story and then be kind of like, look at this weird thing that happened, because I think that's where a lot of media takes it. And it kind of puts the experiencer in a position where then they have to defend their credibility, because it's so hard for people to believe that they're like, well, this person must be lying. And so I know, something we talked about a lot and that was really important to us was that we didn't just want to present these stories, but we wanted to present frameworks and ideas that would help people understand them and make sense of them. And so that it wasn't just the experiencer being on trial, that, you know, we were kind of putting our frameworks and mental models on trial. And so I wonder if you could talk a little bit about, like, what do you see as being, you know, some valuable frameworks that can help people understand the complexities and the nuance and just sort of the bizarre nature of anomalous experiences?
Yeah, I mean, I think some of the frameworks, that's a great question. There are interesting frameworks, like we've been talking about extended sense perception and how it's possible that the limits of our perception define the kinds of experiences that we have. I mean, that's almost certainly the case. And on the show, you know, spoiler alert, Jim Madden, who's been on Dreamland with you, and of course, on Talkalypse Press, our new publishing arm, published his most recent book, Unidentified Flying Hyperobject, largely thanks to you, Kelly. And, you know, Jim goes into great detail talking about concepts like the Umwelt and the Uber-Umwelt, which are really looking at, you know, when we look at, say, insects, say, ticks, or when you think about a tree or your dog, right? You know, people that have pets often recognize, you know, the truth that pets often have an expanded sense of hearing that goes beyond what we do. And often they sense things before we do because of that, right? Or for whatever other reasons that may be there. And so, you know, the concept of the Umwelt is really important in terms of, like, knowing what we can't know, or knowing what we can't perceive. For example, and it's just like, what are the limits of our perception? What are the limits of anybody's perception? And could there be something that we're missing? Could there be some, you know, hidden areas that that other beings, other intelligences may natively live in these areas that we can't perceive, generally speaking? Like, for example, there are a lot of UFO reports that are from infrared situations. We can't see the infrared spectrum, but a lot of UFO footage is from infrared cameras. And so, you know, there's speculation. It's like, are they cloaking themselves, or are they natively living in a realm, or natively existing in a realm that can only be perceived through IR, you know? And, you know, things, we go back and forth about that a lot. So, you know, that's one framing in terms of what can be helpful. Another would be that we talk on the show a bit about the six-layer model, which is a model that Jacques Vallée and Dr. Eric Davis published about, gosh, I think it was back in 2003.
I think that's right, yeah.
Yeah, and it still remains to this day one of the most useful models for, in terms of the ways that people have experiences, in terms of, like, the biological after effects, like social effect. There's the psychic effects, and it really helps in terms of, you know, building a structured understanding of cases and of reportage in a way that can be helpful for being able to kind of elucidate or be more eloquent in terms of getting to the details. When you have models like that, and I highly recommend people either look at a rundown, watch our show, or read the six-layer model paper themselves, because it can be really helpful in terms of how people can talk about their own anomalous experiences with others and recognize that some of the more inconvenient data points, like, for example, time dilation, people often have the sense that time either speeds up or slows down or even stops in their anomalous experiences. And they think that that's impossible often, because it does seem impossible with our current understanding of physics and our current understanding of time. But anybody that really studies time or perception or physics knows that we have so much to learn about time, about space-time, about our perception of time. You know, being able to talk about those inconvenient details like that and recognizing that there are frameworks like the six-layer model, it can be really helpful in us understanding the world that we live in. And I think that that's one of the bigger points that we really try to get at in the show and just in our thinking in general, you and I, is really taking those data points so that people can connect them individually so that we can have more grassroots efforts, more individual efforts, more interpersonal disclosure, and be able to look at those details and say, hey, like, maybe this does point to something that we don't understand about time. And maybe if we address this, maybe if we talk about this time dilation, we'll be able to understand not just what UFOs are, but we'll be able to understand time better and our perception better. And that these are things that are our rights as people, I believe, and I know that you believe this too, that there's that, you know, with all of these cover-ups, like, there's something deeply wrong about having aspects of nature itself, of our the world that we live in, hidden from us. Just even the basic understanding of biology or time or physics, and that, you know, the pursuit of knowledge is such an important factor, you know, in our lives. And arguably, you know, one of the probably, you know, arguably along with love and, you know, companionship, the most, you know, important, you know, meaning making that we can find in terms of, like, why do we live? You know, why do we exist? You know, to push ourselves further, to understand more, to learn, right?
Absolutely. Absolutely. Well, we called the docuseries The Beyond because we wanted to kind of move beyond the traditional narrative around UFOs. I know something that you and I talk about a lot is our kind of frustration that although we absolutely support disclosure, you were in the room when David Grush was testifying in front of Congress along with David Fravor and Ryan Graves. You know, like, we follow that closely, we care about it. But at the same time, we both share this concern that disclosure in some ways is closing the aperture around what we're able to talk about in ufology, and that in some ways we need to reclaim that conversation and reclaim ufology as something that's separate from disclosure. Can you talk a little bit about, you know, where we tried to go with the docuseries in terms of pushing ourselves into the beyond, kind of beyond the conversation that's sort of dominating the narrative right now?
Absolutely. Yeah, it's a great question. You know, I think disclosure, as you say, you know, disclosure efforts in DC and all of those kinds of efforts are super important. I hope for more disclosure efforts around the world, you know, from other countries as well as other organizations, you know, like, for example, people like Diana Basalka, who a lot of the listeners of Dreamland will be very familiar with. People like Diana Basalka and Jeff Kripal, both of whom appear on our show, religious studies professors that have a deep understanding that places like the the Vatican Library and the Vatican Archives, for example, have a lot of work that could be incredibly pertinent and incredibly important for us to have a better understanding of the world that we live in terms of historical anomalies and some of the documents that they have that other people don't generally have access to. So it's not just countries, but other organizations, religious bodies, people that have, you know, that are sitting on archives. There are so many different avenues on an institutional level for disclosure efforts. But, you know, DC can't be it, partially because, you know, like, look at where we are in 2024. Politics are a mess. Capitol Hill is a mess. I mean, that's very uncontroversial to say. I mean, I think that just about any adult, you know, having lived through the last decade has a deep understanding that, you know, things don't work very smoothly in our government bureaucracy often, and that it seems like instability and infighting and partisan behavior and blockades and secrecy, you know, are often kind of more that's more the operating principle than things like transparency, right? And of course, we can't blame the military or defense contractors or intelligence agencies for operating with secrecy, because that's literally what their job is. Literally their job are, you know, national security, you know, finding out, you know, having advantageous information and utilizing it are literally, you know, that's literally what they're paid to do. And so, you know, on one level, we can all be very frustrated about the cover-up, but then we also have to be adults and recognize that we can't blame people for literally doing their jobs, as frustrating as that can be, right? And some of those people, as we know, like, for example, David Grush, yeah, I was there at that hearing. It was powerful. I was incredible. I was so glad to be there. It's one of the more inspiring days within the field for myself, and I'm sure many other people. I think Dave Grush is a hero in a lot of ways for being as brave as he is, given what he knows. But, you know, it's at great risk. And I think that a lot of people should recognize that government bodies themselves know that the problems, you know, they know more intimately. Like when I talk to, you know, when I was there that day and, you know, through other people we know that are either reporters or they're people that kind of operate near there, a lot of those folks know how challenging DC can be. And putting our eggs all in the DC basket is probably a bad idea, because, you know, when we sit there and we think about the hundreds of politicians and their aides and everybody else, you know, that exists in that environment, we can think about people that we more or less agree with, you know, on a personal level or on a political level. But then, you know, it turns into like, who do we really admire, right? Who do we really align with? And I think for a lot of people these days, it's very hard to find more than a handful of people that they personally, you know, believe in or think could really push this ball forward with disclosure effort. And that's just a sad fact, you know. A lot of people that want power are typically do it for the wrong reasons, we find. That's not everybody at all, but, you know, there are people that are doing this for the wrong reasons. Then they get to Congress, and then, you know, Congress itself is often a challenging system. So what do we do? What do we do? We encourage things like what we're doing in the show in terms of what can people do within their families? What can people do with their loved ones? What can people do with their friends? You know, what are independent efforts? What are independent study efforts? Like, how can we use the tools and talents and strengths that we individually have to be able to approach the world around us and recognize, like, hey, there's some stuff that we've been ignoring for a really long time because it's kind of scary, and because we don't understand it. But what do we do as a civilization? What have we always done? We eventually face that stuff, and then we become better for it. And I think that you and I both know, and I think a lot of the listeners out there will understand that, you know, that those kinds of grassroots efforts and that kind of agency is critically important, especially with the world as it exists today. And, you know, waiting for other people to give us the truth when we can dig in ourselves. You know, I think digging in ourselves is the best answer.
I completely agree. Well, I know this has been a really kind of transformational experience for both of us. Can you talk briefly about like one thing that you've learned through this process or one way in which your thinking about the phenomenon has changed?
Oh, wow. It's a good question. The way that I think about the phenomenon has changed in the course of doing this. I guess, let's see. Well, one thing would be, you know, that, say, for example, Courtney, right? In Courtney's case, he has poltergeist phenomena at his ranch house. And he, you know, on a place like Skinwalker Ranch, for example, there's this understanding that poltergeist phenomena is meant to, you know, scare you or meant get to for you to pay attention. And it's in many ways, you know, it's a form of communication. Poltergeist activity is a form of communication, and people don't know a lot about it. One of the more interesting conversations I've had in the last few years was actually with Colin Kelleher about poltergeist phenomena, and him talking about like how it's very interesting that often before somebody has a UFO encounter, or after they have a UFO encounter or an actual entity encounter, that poltergeist phenomena is experienced, sometimes even like prefiguring it by several weeks, and wondering like whether that, you know, we were talking about like whether that is an aspect of detection, whether that's kind of like scoping somebody out and seeing the limits of what they see, you know, the experiencer themselves, whether they're being essentially like staked out. Or, you know, Colin's point was like, well, you know, having an encounter like that is incredibly traumatic. And one of the things that we've considered, you know, when he's talking about we, it's generally, I generally assume that he meant his work in OSAP or NIDS or other contracts that he's had like that to study anomalies. He was like, well, you know, having an entity encounter, that's often very traumatic. And maybe we've explored that, you know, maybe that trauma can even cause micro PK or poltergeist activity. And, you know, what would it mean if we were causing our own poltergeist activity that was prefiguring a traumatic event? You know, we've really looked into that because we understand that we don't know time, and we understand that we don't know psychokinesis and poltergeist activity. I found that absolutely fascinating. And I was thinking about that going into shooting the show. And then, you know, Courtney, we were sitting around a fire at Courtney's ranch and, you know, hanging out with him that day. And he was talking about the poltergeist activity that happens to him at the ranch house. And he also thinks of it as communication. But in his situation, it appears to be communication to him with his deceased relatives. And he thinks of it as much more warm and less foreboding than what other people find within those encounters. And he had such a fresh perspective about that, that I was just blown away in a lot of ways, because it was one of those encounters and one of those conversations. I'm so glad that we had it on camera, you know, because my gosh, you know, there's so much fear about anomalous experience. And any time that people are able to bridge those gaps and find situations where it could be about warmth and communication and have a fresh perspective that way, like, I think that we need to hear that in our culture the way that it exists right now.
Absolutely. Well, that feels like a great place to leave it for the public portion of this show. Jay and I will be continuing on for about another half hour or so for members only. If you'd like to hear that conversation, you can sign up to be a member at unknowncountry.com. Thanks everyone for listening, and we'll see you next time.
You've been listening to Dreamland. Be sure to tune in again next week. Dreamland is brought to you by unknowncountry.com and its family of subscribers. Our theme music is The O of Pleasure by Ray Lynch. Unknown Country was founded by Ann Strieber. Our news editor is Matthew Frizzell. Our coordinator is Amy Safrankova. Whitley Strieber is your Dreamland host. And I'm your announcer, Ted Alexander.